Lionel Richie, Nicole Scherzinger and Katy Perry have hit it out of the park in their performances at the King's Coronation Concert.
And there, of course, we see the arrival of Their Majesties the King and Queen.
As my grandmother said when she was crowned, coronations are a declaration of our hopes for the future. And I know she's up there, fondly keeping an eye on us, and she'd be a very proud mother. I commit myself to serve you all, King, country, and Commonwealth. God save the King.
It had it all, didn't it? Even Kermit the Frog. Let's bring in the Royal Editor of the Daily Mirror, Russell Myers, who's there. Rusty, what a concert!
No doubt. I mean, you just showed an incredible highlights reel, and I think this is what everybody was waiting for, because there was a bit of damp weather yesterday. It didn't dampen too many spirits, but this was a fantastic, incredible event. You know, we just saw Katy Perry. I mean, I can die happy, because seeing Katy Perry singing Firework was a real highlight for me. But, you know, Nicole Scherzinger, we had Kermit the Frog, a Winnie the Pooh tribute. It had it all. I mean, Lionel Richie as well. Fantastic.
It really did have it all. We didn't see Winnie the Pooh. We'll have to check in on that later. I mean, we saw the royals up and about dancing on their feet, including the King and Queen.
I know. God, who would have thought they had some moves? I definitely saw, you know, the Duchess of Edinburgh, Sophie, shaking some moves. But certainly the King and Queen flag waving. The younger royals as well, who have absolutely stolen the show this weekend. I mean, they are definitely stars for the future. And one may hope that this is definitely a new era for the royal family. We've had a couple of years of sort of scandal and infighting, haven't we? But this was a time for celebration, and I definitely think a new leaf for the monarchy.
Yeah, we were just saying how comfortable those young royals looked, and for us it was Louis, of course, who stole the show, as always. He's a legend, isn't he?
Listen, we've just had some fantastic moments with the children this week. I think that Louis yesterday was absolutely impeccably behaved. Yeah. We forget he's only 5 years old. Mm. Prince George having a big role yesterday, and Princess Charlotte. I mean, she is definitely a star for the future.
Absolutely, Russell. Thanks so much for joining us there on your fine. Love it. Take care, mate.
Cheers, guys.
Oh, and you can watch the King's Coronation Concert on Nine and Nine Now from midday today. You don't want to miss it. How good is that? That is the concert celebrating the coronation of King Charles III. Right now underway in the UK, the royal family joining thousands at Windsor Castle for the festivities. And joining us to discuss the coronation as well as the other headlines making news is Minister for Government Services and the NDIS, Bill Shorten, in Canberra. And 3AW's Neil Mitchell in Melbourne. Good morning, gents. Thanks for joining us today. Now, Bill, it's been a huge weekend in the UK, a slightly shorter affair than the last coronation, but no shortage of pomp and pageantry on display.
Oh, hats off to the Brits. They know how to do big events well, and the coronation hasn't been one for a very long time, so it looked like it was a great party.
Yeah, absolutely. That's all you got to say about it?
Oh, well, it's very nice.
No, come on, Bill. Come on.
Well, I'm full confession here. I did get asked Saturday night. I was at an event. I was picking up my 13-year-old daughter from a 14-year-old party, and so that was the coronation I went to, Sophia's 14th party.
Oh, you know, I did pop into a pub in Melbourne, and they weren't playing the coronation. They were playing the footy, so I didn't think that was very cool. So, you know, I got a bit of it on my phone. But anyway, Neil, what did you make of it all? Katy Perry, we just heard from Lionel Richie, was also there.
Oh, yeah, they know how to throw a party, and it had a sense of history about it. And, look, I don't want to do a Stan Grant, but I watched a bit of it. I think it was terrific. But it just reinforced to me how far removed it's from Australia.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, we don't camp out for royals. We camp out for footy tickets.
Yeah.
We don't do that sort of thing. And good on them for doing it. It's terrific for the country and royalty. That's all great. But it just felt so removed from this country.
Yeah. I have to say, it didn't feel like they were dealing with the head of state of Australia. I thought it looked like they were dealing with the head of state of the United Kingdom. Great party, but I'm not sure it really was anyway, we get on with our lives, don't we? We've got things to deal with here.
Yeah, I mean, it was very old-fashioned. I thought it was pretty spectacular, though, given it was a little bit shorter as well, so a bit more of an appetite for it. Yeah. Hey, let's move on now. Bill, we've finally made it to budget week. Rates up again last week. Many families are on edge around the country. How confident are you that your cost of living package will cut it?
I know that Jim Chalmers and our economics team have been working very hard. The reality is cost of living is the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10th issue. It's really tough at the moment. We've seen some tips about what will be in the budget. I think it's exciting that there could be up to $500 relief for family energy bills for up to 5 million households and a million small businesses. So I think that's a promising sign, which we'll find out more about tomorrow night.
Yeah, I mean, Neil, you know just how tough it is out there, all the callers who speak to you every morning. I mean, this $1.5 billion energy bill relief package will only cover up to 40 or 50% of households. Is that enough? What more do you think we can do here?
Well, it's tough to do anything. It's tough to live and it's tough to do anything. I mean, Bill's on the talking points, but don't forget, we're paying 20% more income tax. $300 billion, 20% more. Commodities are surging. The government's getting a lot of money coming in. And what they've got to do is manage it very carefully, help us. I can't see how this cost of living assistance won't be inflationary, and that's something they've got to balance very carefully. Bill, one of your bosses said you've got to look in the bottom drawer to save some money. What did you find in the bottom drawer? Forget the talking points. What did you actually find?
Well, we've identified five areas of expenditure where we've got to tackle. I know that in the NDIS, the way we make that better is to focus on outcomes for participants and make sure that every dollar is getting through to the person for whom the scheme was designed. I think also there's a reference in some of today's papers about the petroleum rent review tax. So on one hand, about making that fit for purpose. So on one hand, we've make sure our big LNG companies are paying their fair share, but on the other, restraint within government and making sure that we're focusing on effective use of government dollars, not just more dollars.
But that is the thing, isn't it? I mean, what you touch on there, Neil, Katie Gallagher, who's on the show in a little bit, was talking about each industry finding it cuts, portfolio finding cuts where they can. Neil, it's going to be significant. You're going to have to find lots of cuts.
Yeah, well, you know, they'll find cuts and they'll hurt and there'll be people screaming about them. That's the difficulty in the balance. I just repeat the point that the government's got a lot of money and it's got a lot more money through migration, through income tax, all these other things. And you know, they'll say it's terrific financial management. It's not. We've thrown money at them. Now comes the financial management. Let's see how they do it. Mm. It's going to be a tough way to get that balance right. But look, budget's all about spin. That's all we get. It's all, you know, we're getting all this spin now and we'll get more spin on them during the week and we'll just see where we end up.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, well, finally, Victoria is pretty... You wanted to add to that, Bill?
No, I just... No. I think you'll find that we'll see if we haven't got something that makes Neil smile tomorrow night. Ooh. That's a challenge, isn't it?
Yeah, that is
there's
a challenge.
There's sorting out the budget, then there's making Neil smile about it.
Well, what about be honest about the debt? I mean, you keep going on about the debt. Half of the debt comes from the pandemic relief, which you approved.
Yeah, I'm happy to be honest about the debt. There's $1.2 trillion of Liberal debt.
We were waiting for that one, and you finally got there. All right.
You can't blame me. We weren't co-conveners during that period, Neil. There was one mob in charge. I mean, actually...
Scott Morrison was
co-convener to himself, probably. Anyway, who knows? Anyway, you're right. That's history. History.
Let's move on now quickly. Victoria is producing far fewer babies than New South Wales, with some suburbs recording more deaths than births. Bill, what's going on down south?
I felt patriotic when I saw that. I felt, they can't say that about Melbourne. Apparently, it's the housing costs that families in some suburbs of Melbourne, young families, are priced out of the market. Mm. That's probably true. I saw one theory which said that women find it easy to get jobs in Melbourne, so they're not having babies. I don't know if that's right. I know in my own household I've seemed to be accounting for three young people, so I feel like we're doing our thing in the shortened household.
Mm. Neil, what do you reckon it is? I mean, could it be cost of living?
No, it's Daniel Andrews. He's a walking contraceptive, Daniel Andrews.
If all else fails, blame him.
Why on earth would... Why would you want to have kids when you can't get into school, hospital, trains, the roads are clogged?
Neil,
it's all Daniel's fault.
I'm surprised you haven't blamed Daniel Andrews if the chickens don't lay eggs, mate.
Oh, that's coming.
That's funny you mentioned that. It's raining.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for your time this Monday morning. Carl.
It's a brand new contraceptive ads to the kids out there. When you're making love, think of Dan Andrews.
Oh,
well, life is a highway, as they
sometimes
say in the classics. Terrific weekend, folks. Hope you had a
yes.
good one. As we go to where it continues, the newly crowned King Charles III and the royal family have joined thousands at Windsor for the coronation concert. It's the star-studded finale to an historic weekend of royal events with Katy Perry and Lionel Richie to perform.
It's been a busy day already for the royals, Kate and William joining street parties in Windsor.
Oh.
Let's go live to Europe correspondent Edward Godfrey, who joins us now from Windsor. Edward, good morning. The concert is just kicking off.
Yeah, good morning, guys. We've had the pomp and the pageantry. Now is the time to party, and the coronation concert has just begun inside the walls of Windsor Castle, just behind us here, about 45 minutes or so from London. Some vision has popped up where you can see the enormous setup inside, just that huge stage lit up in red, white and blue, and 20,000 people packed in on the lawn around that stage. And I'm told that the King has just arrived a few moments ago and has received three cheers. We know it's going to be a star-studded affair. It's being hosted by Hugh Bonneville. There are going to be performances, as you said, from Lionel Richie and Katy Perry, who are at the coronation service, and they've known the King for quite some time. We're also expecting some recorded messages of some kind from Tom Cruise and Tom Jones, perhaps revealing some unknown details about King Charles. Windsor has been pumping all day. We've got 20,000 people here in attendance, and many of them arrived very early, and those who did were rewarded because the Prince and Princess of Wales, William and Kate, stopped along the long walk just near us where we are at the moment and did a bit of a walkabout earlier this afternoon and spent quite a long time going along and shaking people's hands and taking selfies. William and Kate accepting drinks from members of the crowd there as well. And there was a really touching moment where there was a little girl wearing Union Jacks and she was crying. She was a little bit overcome with it all, a little bit overwhelmed, and Kate spent some time consoling her and gave her a big hug. So something that she will never forget. Around half the people here received their ticket through a ballot. They're inside now enjoying themselves, and I'm just told that Kate and William are there and George and Charlotte, but guys, there's no Louis, apparently. We know he likes to steal the show, so perhaps he's been left home for that reason.
Come on, we need Louis.
He's a naughty
he's
boy.
He's the best one.
I'm transfixed by him.
Yeah,
you can watch the King's Coronation concert on 9 and 9 now from midday. Today as well as some highlights through the morning.